Casper's Backseat. My name is Casper Stockham. You know, during the evenings, I drive for Uber and Lyft, but during the day, I get a chance to interview movers and shakers here in Colorado. Well, I had the mover and shaker right here in my backseat, Mr. Derek Wolkman. Now, Derek is the founder of the Rocky Mountain Black Conservatives, and he's also currently the state vice chair for the Republican Party. He's also part of the reason why I am running for Congress, so maybe we'll get into that as well. Hey, Derek, welcome to Casper's Backseat.
Love being in the backseat. I have done some of my best work in the backseat.
Yeah, I bet you have. We'll get into that a little bit later. Anyway, so I always like to ask my guests in my backseat one simple question. If you were king for a day, what would you change to make our world a better place or our country a better place? And what would you do if you were king for a day?
If I were king for a day, since I'm in the political realm, mm-hmm. If I were king for a day, I would require an audit of every federal agency to determine whether or not it is constitutionally appropriate and operating within the bounds and reins of the United States Constitution.
Okay. And you think that would be a major, that would really help get things back in line?
There's no question it would. We've reached the point now where there's so much extra constitutional things taking place. First of all, we can't afford it. Mm-hmm. It's costing us a fortune.
Right.
And if we were just to have the federal government stay inside the boundaries set for it by the Constitution and let the states govern the states, everything would be better.
Huh. Interesting. And then once you did that, you would step down from being king of the day.
Well, that's what you told me.
Just one day.
Now, if you want to make me king for a decade, we could talk about that. I could really change that.
No, I think king for a day is about all we can take.
Right.
So you're a founder of the Rocky Mountain Black Conservatives, and I am, of course, familiar with that organization because I was president of the organization. But tell the folks watching this video kind of how all that came about.
It's a long story how it came about. Rather than go to the history, let me give you the current or
okay.
the mission.
Okay.
And the idea is real simple, that the way that we, ethnic minorities and specifically blacks in America, the way that we vote is unhealthy for everybody. Nobody's winning. So there is no such thing as a situation in which competition does not benefit the consumer.
Right.
Competition always benefits the consumer.
Right.
What we as black Americans have done is we've said to one political party, we will only vote for you. Every time, all the time, doesn't matter, we are only voting for you, and that's just not smart, it's just not healthy. Whether or not Republican policies and principles are right or wrong, and I would argue that more of them are right than Democrat policies, of course, but whether that's true or not, we would be in better shape in our communities, we'd be in better shape just as a voter bloc in our nation if the Democrat Party was aware there's a chance we could lose them.
Right.
So we've created a situation in our nation now where you have a two political party structure.
Mm-hmm.
That's the matter of fact. A lot of people don't like it. I don't like it, but
right.
that's just the matter of fact.
Right.
And neither party has incentive to court the black vote.
Yeah.
The Republicans can say, well, you know, why invest the resources to
exactly.
go from 6% to 7%?
Exactly.
It's just not worth it. And the Democrats can say, why invest the resources? They're going to vote for us regardless.
Anyway. I always say that the Democrat Party has exploited the black community and brown community, and the Republican Party has ignored the black and brown community.
Between a rock and a hard place. Exactly. So the organization and my position now in the party has been to start focusing the efforts of the conservatives and the conservative movement in our country on effectively reaching out to the minority community.
Okay. And now you are the state vice chair, and I was there for that election. That was something to behold.
It was. It was. And I'll tell you that you're talking about March of 2015.
Mm-hmm.
And I've said many times since that I am living proof that Republicans are not racists.
Right.
I'm living proof.
I am as well.
You are as well. You know, the white Republicans of this state can't wait to vote for you. There were four people running for my office when I was running last year. Three of them white and me. And everyone who's anyone who knows anything about this game and the way the rules are said that this will require at least two ballots.
Right.
So the way things work in Colorado and in most states too, I'm sure, is if you have multiple people on the you're going to split the vote up. It's just the math just isn't there. Mm-hmm. Well, on the first ballot, as you know, I won.
Yeah, I was there.
So, you know, room full of, you know, honey, that's not to say, look at me, how great I am.
Sure.
The point is, there's 400, 500, 600 white Republicans sitting there, and they listen to what we believe in, articulated our positions, the values and things that we want to bring to the office, and they said, you know what, we'll take the black guy.
Yeah, yeah. And now with my race, it's one of the, there's been other black candidates, but this year, you know, I'm candidate for seat one, and Daryl Glenn is the senatorial candidate for the state, so, you know.
And he also wanted running away.
Yes, he did. He did a fantastic job on that.
Running away. So, I mean, we've got a state with a black population that is less than the national average. Nationally, we comprise of about 13% of the population of the entire country, right, about 12.9.
Right.
Here in Colorado, we're only 3 or 4.
Right.
And then, of course, of blacks who are registered Republicans, you've got an even smaller subset. So, the people who voted in the Republican primary were overwhelmingly Caucasian.
Right.
In Colorado. Overwhelmingly.
Right.
I don't know the number off the top of my head, but probably 98%+.
Yeah.
And they gave the victory to Daryl Glenn in a walk.
70%.
In a walk.
Yeah.
So the idea that Republicans don't Republicans, for the most part, are there racist Republicans? Of course.
Yeah.
Are there racist Democrats? Independents?
Yeah.
Green? Of course there are. But the idea that Republicans will not get behind and support a minority candidate is absolute foolishness. They care about content of character, articulation, and ability to promote an agenda that we believe in. And if that's what you put on the table, white Republicans will look right past your skin color and vote for you in a heartbeat. And the panel discussion that you and I hosted at the Western Conservative Summit three weeks ago, as of this filming,
right,
is proof.
Right. Yeah, and you had a comment about the fact that I can't remember it exactly, but you're talking about crawling across
broken glass and nails?
Yeah, yeah. What was that comment again?
That ended up getting picked up nationally. I said, obviously it was hyperbole, but white Republicans would get on their hands and knees and crawl across a football field of broken glass and nails to cast a vote for Alan West, or Condoleezza Rice, or Tim Scott, or Daryl Glenn, or me, or you, instantly.
Right.
But the same people would not accept a chauffeured champagne and caviar Rolls Royce limousine ride from here to the end of the street to go vote for a white liberal.
Right.
It's just not true.
Right.
It's just not true. But, you know, the left knows that it isn't true, and they need to keep this lie alive. They need to keep the hate alive. For all their rhetoric about hate and bigotry and stuff, they love to trot it out.
Mm-hmm.
The fact is, they need it.
Yeah.
They need it because the Caucasian vote in our country is about 50-50.
Right.
Always is. Last election, I believe Obama got 52% of the white vote.
Mm-hmm.
But the black vote is 90-10. The Hispanic vote is 70-30.
Right.
So if we, ethnic minorities, if we began voting like the rest of the country votes,
right, half and half at least,
Democrats couldn't elect a county dog catcher.
Wow.
And they know that.
Wow.
So we don't talk about economic issues. We don't talk about bringing jobs back to the community. We don't talk about empowering parents to choose where their children go to school to better the chances of their future. We
right.
don't talk about this. So all we talk about is how much Republicans hate blacks and how racist they all are.
Yeah, yeah. Well, you know, I think the dial is moving, the needle is moving in the right direction, but we've got a lot of work to do. The work that you're doing, the work that I'm trying to do as well. So I really appreciate you being in the back seat, and make sure you don't mess it up back there.
Too late. Too late. I've already had a accident. Okay. If you don't know what I'm talking about, let's just put it this way. It depends.
All right. I got you. Hey, folks, welcome to Caster's Backseat, and we'll see you on the next interview. Thanks.